Welcome to First Congregational United Church of Christ here in Whiting, Iowa. Where no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. So happy to have you all here with us this morning. We are happy to see the rain. Hopefully it will continue a little bit more. I'd like to begin with announcements on the back of your bulletin, and then there's a couple I need to tell you about. Not make it into the vault. If you have a favorite hymn that you would like sung during worship, let me know. You can also write it on the sign-up sheet there in the back of the sanctuary. I will be on vacation from September 5th to the 18th. And so during that time, you can contact Becky Cooper. We had a council meeting here last week, and the minutes for that will be on the bulletin board in the back of the sanctuary. And of course, we all know about the crop walk coming up. And then September 25th, we're working with Mayflower to do a joint outside service in the park, looking at possibly Snyder's Bend or Brown's Lake, to celebrate my one-year anniversary. Hard to believe it. It's already been a year, but I've been with you now for one full year. Of course, the joint tri-state annual meeting coming up in October, the dates are there. One thing I need to tell you about that is not in the bulletin. Oh, we are collecting school supplies for the local Whiting school in the West Central Development. And all of the things that are needed are on the insert list in your bulletin. And we've already started to get quite a pile there in the back pew of the sanctuary. You can leave what you got there or get in touch with Fran.
Yeah, because they have to be there by Thursday.
By Thursday, so August 10th.
We're going
to
take one
load
down tomorrow.
Yeah. Anything you got, even by Thursday, the school kids will be very appreciative. One other thing that didn't make it into the bulletin is the warming shelter in Sioux City is having a fundraiser on August 21st, and the New Horizons band will be playing, and that is at Redeemer Lutheran. Linda Davis, who is a member of our congregation, is a part of that New Horizons band. I should have wrote the time on there, but I didn't.
It's 2:30.
Oh, is it 2:30? Okay. I'll announce it again next week. We'll get in there.
But there's a hot dog lunch or something, free will donation.
Oh, yeah.
It goes to the warming shelter.
Yeah.
Their band is good. They're fun to listen to. So
I heard a lot about it, but I will be there because I have Jess here again. So. Any other announcements?
We do Troy's blessing
on
the backpack.
Oh, you want to do that right now? Okay. Troy, come on up. Let's bless your backpack.
We'll be having blessing of the backpacks on the 21st of August, but Troy's going to be away with his sister that weekend, so I said he could bring his today.
Were you? Is that when you're going to the zoo with your sister? Okay. Oh, it's a nice backpack. Brand name. All right, let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we ask that your blessings be upon this backpack and be upon Troy as he begins a new school year. May this backpack bring learning that helps expand the mind and empowers him for the journey of life which will be ahead of him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Oh, and we've got a blue bag here for you. Not sure what's in it. It's a secret. Other announcements for the good order of the church. queries or concerns? Yes?
Some people might remember Jeannie Patterson. She used to live around here, and she's not very good.
Jeannie Patterson. And I was informed this week that two congregants at Mayflower passed away. Joanne Johnson, her service will be this week, and Terry Coghlan. So we keep their family in our thoughts and prayers. Any other joys, concerns, prayer requests? All right, let us go to God in prayer with a few moments of our own silent meditation. Gracious and loving God, we ask that you open up your holy word to us this day. Speak to us in the same way that you spoke to Abraham and Sarah when you first called them to be instruments of your blessing. Empower us to embody your word in our everyday lives. Help us when we get discouraged and feel like giving up. Always keep reminding us, like you did with Abraham and Sarah, of your promises. Help us to always trust, to have faith in you, O Lord. This day, O Lord, we lift up to you our joys and our concerns. We pray for the residents in Pleasant View, our homebound that are unable to be here with us today. We pray for the conflict in Russia and Ukraine, that you would bring peace to that conflict. We lift up to you the families of Terry Coghlan and Joanne Johnson. We ask that you be with them and give them your peace as they go through this time of loss, hardship. Lord, we also lift up to you Jeannie Patterson, that your peace would also be with her and your assurances. And Lord, we lift up Troy to you, and we want to celebrate with him as he begins a new school year, that you would be with him and guide him as he begins to his journey, which is a lifelong journey of learning and of becoming an adult. Lord, we lift up all these things to you in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray by boldly saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and glory forever. Amen. Now would you please rise, if able, for the singing of the Gloria Patri. Now join me in the call to worship. congregational response is in the bolded print in your bulletin and also on the screen. The Lord comes to us this day. Are you ready?
We are ready.
The Lord challenges us to be in ministries of peace and hope. Are you ready?
We are ready.
Let us praise God who calls us to serve God by helping others. Praise be
to God who has given us soul and peace. Amen.
Our opening hymn for this morning, and it will also be the hymn of the month, is Great is Your Faithfulness, number 423 in the New Century Hymn.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You're going to be on the library.
Yeah.
Awesome.
morning.
What do you believe is in this bag? Okay, books. Anything else? School supplies. That's a good guess. How about you all out there? What do you believe is in this bag?
A newspaper?
Okay. A magazine?
Candy.
Okay, yeah. All right, well, let's take a look and see what's in this bag. Got a road atlas here. And we've got the yellow book. What is this? Oh, we got a road map. That might come in handy. Can you still use the map? Probably have GPS. Oh, look, we've got some suckers in here. That one bit the dust. Okay. So, if I told you all of this was in this bag, but I didn't show it to you, would you believe me? Okay, why would you believe me? You trust me. Good, good. Now, when I pull it out of the bag, you know, it's easy to trust when I show it to you because I can see that, you know, this is a lollipop. I can look at it. I can taste it. I can see that, you know, this is an atlas. I can open it up and look at it and, you know, see it is what it is. But if I didn't actually open up this bag and show you these things, you would have to trust me that I was telling you the truth, right? So that's how it is with God. God is, we can't see God. We can only, you know, experience Him or her in our everyday lives. God is something that is unseen. So that's what it means to be a person of faith, is to put your trust in God. Gracious and loving God, we ask that you always help us to trust in you, put our trust in you, even though we cannot see you, but we can feel you, and always help us to be faithful. In Jesus' name we pray. So you can't take these, because that's for my next children's message, but there's candy down. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, You have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him, This man shall not be your heir. No one but your own very issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, Look toward heaven and count the stars. If you are able to count them, then he said to him, So shall your descendants be. And he believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. This is the word of the Lord. Our next hymn is Forward Through the Ages, number 377 in your New Century Hymnal. Not seen. Indeed, by faith, our ancestors received approval. By faith, we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made from things that are not visible. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he set out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he stayed for a time in the land he had been promised, as in a foreign land, living in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked forward to the city that has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith he received power of procreation, even though he was too old, and Sarah herself was barren, because he considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one person, and this one as good as dead, descendants were born, as many as the stars of heaven, and as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. All of those died in faith without having received the promises, but from a distance they saw and greeted them. They confessed that they were strangers and foreigners on the earth. For people speak in this way, make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of the land that they had left behind, they would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country that is a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God. Indeed, he has prepared a city for them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This morning, we are beginning a four-week message series for the month of August called Pillars of Faith. Pillars are those stone beams that help hold a building up so it stays up, like the picture we have today for the sermon illustration. Each week, we will be exploring what we can learn from our biblical ancestors about what it means to have faith, what does it mean to be a person of faith, and how does faith work? The ancestor of faith that we will be focusing on this morning is Abram, who will become Abraham, and Sarai, who will become Sarah. The story of Abraham and Sarah begins with God calling them to leave their native homeland, to go to a land that God will show them. God says to Abraham that God will bless them and will create a great nation through them. God will use Abraham and Sarah both to be a blessing to others, really the whole world. He'll be using them to save the world. Abraham is 75 years old when God calls him to leave everything that he has known so that God can use him and Sarah to create this great nation for God. Can you imagine what this must have been like for them? As an older couple who probably thought all of their traveling days were done and over with, those of you here who are 70 and above, how would you respond to call like this from God? Besides their age, Abraham and Sarah have another obstacle to contend with. Sarah is barren, unable to have children, and Abraham is well past his time. The writer of Hebrews puts it like this: he is as good as dead. So how could God possibly create a great nation through them? It all seems very impossible. Abraham and Sarah despite all of these challenges, respond to the call of God to go on what appears to be an impossible journey with God. How many of you here today are planners? You're going on vacation, you like to plan. Okay, we've got quite a few planners here. You like to have your whole week planned out in advance. If you're going on vacation, you want each route down path, which turn to take, all of that. I can imagine that this type of a calling would be difficult for you because you really have no idea of what you will be doing and where you will be going. Those of you who like to plan all of your vacation trips out in advance so that you know exactly which turns you want to take, exactly how long it will take to get to your destination, would definitely not like this. There are members of my family that I've traveled with that will raise the biggest fit you can imagine if we miss the turn that they thought we needed to take on the map. If we adjust or alternate the trip any, they just pitch a fit. They will go unnamed. Faith begins with trusting in God, allowing God to lead you where God wants you to go, even when you're not sure where that is. Trust can be a difficult thing for us, especially when we are trusting in something that we cannot see. We can feel, we can't physically see, at least most of us. We have to turn all of the plans over to God and let God take the wheel. Like any other kind of relationship, trust does not happen right away. It is developed over time. In couples counseling, they have what is called a trust fall, where your significant other stands behind you and you have to trust that he or she is going to catch you. Similar to that. The initial leap of faith, though, is just the beginning. The second aspect of faith beyond trust is being able to endure. Endurance of tests and trials that come along the way while you are on this journey with God, and everybody that follows God has them. There are times when you will have your doubts and wonder whether or not God will keep God's own promises. Or perhaps we're just delusional. Who knows? It's faith. Abraham was brought to the land, but he and Sarah had to live there as foreigners inside of tents. God would use them to create a people, but they would not live to see the fullness of what God was going to do through them. Abraham and Sarah endure all kinds of trials where their faithfulness is tested. My initial leap of faith happened when I decided to become an ordained minister, believe it or not. It was not an easy journey for me. I had to really discern how I could go about doing this. Before I made this initial leap into seminary, I was working full-time as a corrections sergeant for the Missouri Department of Corrections, and I worked odd hours. How was I possibly going to be able to do this? But it was a call that just would not leave me alone. God managed to find a way. I discovered Central Baptist Theological Seminary, which was an ecumenical American Baptist affiliated seminary that had students from all different kinds of denominations across the spectrum. What attracted me most to them was they had a part-time Master's of Divinity program for students who had full-time jobs, making it possible for them to go to seminary. But how was I going to pay for all of this? There were risks involved with that because seminaries are not cheap. And if I loaned money to go there, there was no guarantee that I would make enough to pay it back. Also, there was no guarantee that I would be ordained at all, because you have to go through a process in the churches to become an ordained minister. And there was always the possibility on a committee, search committee, but also the main committee of the entire denomination to say, no, we don't think you're ordained. We don't think you're called to be an ordained ministry. All of this while you're going through seminary, spending money. Ordained ministry is not as simple as getting an online degree from the Universal Church. Each step of the way, there are times when I had my doubts. I always relented and I let God guide me through. God continued to affirm my calling, though, all along the way. But there were times that I needed reminders. The seminary had scholarships that they gave to every student at Central to get them started. Now, they did not cover everything, but it did cover at least a good portion of the tuition. There were scholarships through my denomination, and I applied for those and received multiple scholarships through the Disciples Women's Fellowship. There was also all of the overtime that I could take advantage of to make up the difference, which I did. And after 4 years, both of these things made it possible for me to fulfill the ordination requirements I needed to as an ordained pastor, at the same time receiving a Master's of Divinity degree debt-free, not having borrowed one dime. In our scripture reading from Genesis 15, God appears to Abraham in a vision, and Abraham lets God know that, hey, he's childless. So how can all this even be possible? God sends him outside and directs his attention to the sky and asks him to count the stars. God then tells him that this is how many descendants you shall have. Abraham has begun to grow weary on this journey that he's been on with God, and he has begun to doubt that God is going to fulfill God's promises. God has to remind Abraham that the promise will come to pass. Multiple times throughout the story of Abraham, God has to repeat to Abraham this same promise. We are all a lot like Abraham. We have to be continuously reminded of the promises that God has for us. Christian musician David M. Bailey was diagnosed with terminal brain cancer in his 20s. And during a youth conference, he reflected upon how this had affected him, his family, and his entire life. He decided to quit his corporate job, and he dedicated the rest of his life to his passion for the guitar, and used that passion to bring hope to others through his singing career. The transformation that he went through came about when he decided one day to no longer say to God, "Why me?" Instead, he began to ask God, "What's next?" David Bailey, like Abraham, was willing to turn everything over to God. They didn't complain, saying, "Why me? Couldn't you have picked somebody else?" Instead, they said, "What's next, God?" And they let God lead them along the way. In our scripture reading from Hebrews, a pastor is addressing a congregation that is losing their faith. And he is trying to give them encouragement. And he is trying to remind them of all of their glorious ancestors and all of the promises that God had for them and still has for the congregation that he's addressing in this letter to that day. Presbyterian minister and New Testament scholar Dr. Thomas Long describes the condition of this congregation that the preacher is writing to in Hebrews like this. The congregation is exhausted, tired of serving the world, tired of worship, tired of Christian education, tired of being peculiar in society, tired of spiritual struggles, tired of trying to keep their prayer life going, and even tired of Jesus. Many are beginning to find angels to be more attractive than Jesus. Their hands droop and their knees are weak. Attendance is down at the Hebrews church. They are losing confidence, and many are considering leaving the faith altogether. During the pandemic and after, we have been bombarded with the news, constant depressing news of declining numbers of churches. We wonder whether or not our church will survive into the future. Those fears, I believe, have kept us from seeing into the future and have kept us from seeing the promises that God still has for us today. Yes, we are an older congregation, but remember, it was Abraham and Sarah, an older married couple, that God decided to use in order to bless and save the whole world. God is not finished with us yet, and I think we all need reminders in the midst of our own trials that the promises of God are still real and alive. If God can raise up a couple like Abraham and Sarah to bless an entire world, the entire world, then I believe there is more that God can do with our church even today. The first pillar of faith that we learned from Abraham and Sarah is that we have to claim and lay a hold of the promises of God. Then we must take that leap of faith, trusting in God, stepping into that future land that God is leading us into. Amen. Now we will have a music video, What Faith Can Do, by Pettis. now it is time for this morning's offering, where we share our gifts of time, talent, and treasure, so that the church can embody its mission in our community and in the world. Jesus says, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Let our hearts direct the use of our resources, our time, and our talents. May our generosity meet God's abundance in attending to the needs and hopes of our community. Let us begin this morning's offering. Brothers and sisters, it is at this table of faith where we practice communion that we learn about how to be people of faith through the broken bread and the cup poured out. Everyone who wants to trust and follow in God to be people of faith are welcome at this table. Now our communion hymn is "Come to the Table of Grace," number 112 in your singing book. grateful hearts, O God, we come to Christ's table, remembering that you spoke creation into existence and pronounced it good. Remembering that you called servants to make your word known and declare your reign. Remembering that you effected salvation through Jesus Christ and reconciled us to you. Be known to us now through the gift of your Spirit. In the breaking of bread and the drinking of cup, renew your image within us. Restore our trust in your love. Refresh our trust in your love. Refresh our spirits for caring service. Join us with all your people everywhere in joyous praise for your everlasting love. Amen. On the night of betrayal and desertion, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, my life, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the supper, in a similar way, he took the cup, and after pouring out the wine, he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. And I tell you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine again until that day I drink it with you in the kingdom of God's love." The table is ready, and all are welcome to partake. Deacons will come forward and pass each element out to you individually, and then we will hold on to it and take them all together as one. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Go out into the world with the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen. For it is in the depth of our faith that our hearts will find the treasure that will keep our lamps lit. Thanks be to God. Amen.